building, equipping, and supporting nursing home care staff with the knowledge, skills, and confidence in managing residents with mental disorders by Norhayah Noor from Singapore.
Hi, good afternoon to all, everyone, and thank you so much, Ms. Moderator. I am so fortunate, I'm so privileged to be able to come here to share on one of the work that we have done, my team and I have done in the community, that is capacity building, equipping and supporting nursing home care staff with the knowledge, skills and confidence in managing residents with mental disorders. Singapore is a very gorgeous country, but sadly, we are also aging, with the proportion of residents aged 65 years and over has increased from 8.7% to 13.7% within 10 years. That said, psychiatric disorders are a common health problem in the elderly nursing home residents and is often under-recognized and under-treated. Dementia, depression, and anxiety disorders are the most common psychiatric disorders among older adults in long-term care. My project team is known as the Community Psychogeriatric Program, or we call it CPGP in short, and we run a mental health training program for staff of the elder care agencies and nursing homes in the eastern part of Singapore and SingHealth boundaries. Our aim is to improve mental health knowledge and skills of staff providing care to the older person related to psychogeriatrics, improving the capacity, and performance of the staff. More than 200 staff at one nursing home in Singapore attended a 40-structured mental health training program between 2011 to 2018. Our training program comprises of the basic, the core, the intermediate, and elective, which is optional. Participants are required to have prior knowledge before moving on to the intermediate modules. Therefore, it is compulsory for them to actually complete the core modules. In the core modules, the participants were taught on how to use the two screening tools, which is the AMT for detection of cognitive impairment and EBAS for detection of probable depressive disorders. Residents who were detected and screened, you know, after the training will be then referred to their own resident doctor for further assessment and investigation. Training program is between 4 to 8 hour workshops. We have lectures, we have role play, we have case studies, some video discussion, and also some experiential learning. Okay, so this is the training process. Okay, the whole training process comprises of three parts. 2 to 3 months before we actually went down to conduct the training, we conducted training needs analysis, or we call it TNA, and also focus group. The training program for the particularly nursing home will be depending on the outcome of TNA as well as the focus group discussion. Training program will then be customized according to what the needs are. On the actual training, the participants need to do a pre-test survey just before the lecture start. Post-test survey, this is to test the immediate knowledge at the end of the session, and of course, a training evaluation form. So within 3 to 6 months post-training, we offer free case discussion sessions. This is actually the platform for the staff to discuss any complex cases that they have, and they have difficulty managing the cases. Case discussions, actually roundtable discussion held at the nursing home every 3 monthly with 2 or 2.5 hour per session with some 10 to 5 attendees. Session led by CPGP nurse, myself, with various inputs by doctor and allied health members. And it begins with a resident's profile sharing by nursing home staff on the behaviors of concern. Our case discussion approach uses person-centered care as the guiding principles, okay, in which we look at the resident's biological, psychosocial, and spiritual aspects. The first important factor that we look at is to exclude delirium, okay, followed by other aspects. For residents with dementia, we emphasize so much on managing the behaviors using non-pharmacological ways beyond the pill approach. The staff were also encouraged to link the theories, concepts, or behavior strategies that they have learned during the training program to manage the residents. So in this session, we actually try to recap the knowledge that they have gained during the training program. Of course, not forgetting the spiritual and the end-of-life aspects, which we think are also important for the nursing home staff to communicate with the residents' family members. Working in the nursing home with full capacity, everybody knows that it's so much overwhelming task. Okay, we take this opportunity to actually explore the stress level of the staff and try to figure out, identify the signs of burnout, and we will teach them how to prevent burnout. Yeah, and we also suggested formation of staff peer support system actually to address the staff emotional needs. On a positive note, staff expressed increase in confidence level in managing the difficult cases, and they also shared that the sessions built up their skills. They were able to gradually integrate theory learned into their daily practice and improve the delivery of care. We believe in empowering people to the next level, so therefore, we actually propose support the trainer program, where the nursing home are encouraged to identify potential staff in the nursing homes who have the potential to be the future trainers for the in-house courses. Overall, the mental health training and case discussion sessions conducted over the years did improve some aspects in mental health knowledge among the nursing home staff. They recognized the need to provide more attention for the psychosocial needs of the elderly in the nursing home. We are happy to be a service team that provides a little bit of value to the nursing home and making a difference in the delivery of care. And with that, I thank you so much for your attention. Questions?
That was excellent. Does anybody have any questions? There's microphones, I believe, set up.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Okay, for our next presentation, it is Countering the Global Nursing Faculty Shortage, the Critical Need for Educational Coursework in the Doctor of Nursing Practice Curriculum. And I'd like to introduce Dr. Emerson Ia from the United States.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Emerson Ia, and I'm here with my co-presenter, Dr. Margaret Rafferty, and along with members of the team that include Dr. Alfez, Dr. Chavez, and Dr. Joyce Fitzpatrick, we thank ICN for the opportunity to present on this topic. Dr. Rafferty will present first, and then I will follow after her.
Thank you. The objectives for this presentation are to describe briefly, one, the global nurse and nurse faculty shortages, two, describe how DNP-prepared nurse faculty could mitigate the worsening faculty shortage, and three, discuss nurse educator preparation and competencies as outlined by the American Association of Colleges of Nursing, the National League for Nursing, and the World Health Organization. As we have heard many times during this conference, nurses and midwives make up over 50% of the global healthcare workforce. The United Nations Sustainable Goals, I'm gonna just go here. Oh, there we go. Okay. The United Nations Sustainable Development Goals cannot be implemented without a robust nursing workforce. This picture outlines the relationship between the healthcare workforce and the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals. The World Health Organization has done a tremendous amount of work on the global health workforce in the last few years. There are several documents available at the WHO website that provide a rich resource for information about the global workforce issues. The Global Strategy on Human Resources for Health Workforce 2030 articulate the vision, goals, principles, and objectives of the project. A companion piece, Global Strategic Directions for Strengthening Nursing and Midwifery 2016-2020 is also a rich resource. Both resources are available at no cost at the World Health Organization website. Data from the World Health Organization is available here. These are the latest data from WHO. On this slide, it goes by region, and there are approximately 25 million nurses in 2013, and that number slightly increased to 28.5 million in 2016. The World Health Organization estimates that by 2030, the shortage of nursing and midwives will be 7.6 million nurses. This is a very significant number. While it is encouraging that some progress has been made, there is still a long way to go in meeting the health needs of people around the globe. The shortage in war-torn areas like Syria and Afghanistan remain severe and are predicted to worsen by 2030. In order to implement universal health care, the current shortfall must be eliminated. The majority of nurses are women, and if gender equity is to be achieved, working conditions and pay must also be improved. 2 billion people have been affected by disasters in the last two decades, which is another compelling reason to grow the nursing workforce. The Sustainable Development Goals will never be achieved without nursing faculty who are prepared both as excellent clinicians and also as excellent teachers. Nursing faculty are essential to help nursing students gain the necessary competencies to care for patients. The nursing faculty role is complex and the learning curve is steep. Great clinicians who transfer to academia often report stress with transitioning to the new role. It's difficult to be a newbie after a long, accomplished career as a nurse administrator or clinician. The American Nurses, American Association of Colleges of Nursing estimate that almost one-third of the nursing faculty will retire by 2025. This shortage particularly affects nurse faculty who work with doctoral students. Only about 1 to 2% of nurses have earned a doctoral degree, and there is acute need for doctorally prepared faculty. The Future of Nursing Report set a goal to double the number of doctorally prepared nursing faculty by 2020. Factors associated with the global nursing faculty shortage include aging faculty and poor salary. Educators in the United States are paid $20,000 less than their colleagues who work in nursing service. Global migration and dissatisfaction with the role are other factors. Academia requires the faculty to publish or perish. Balancing teaching responsibilities with scholarship can be a challenge for nursing faculty. The DNP has exceeded everyone's expectations. The DNP is clearly an idea whose time has come. Nurses have enrolled in DNP programs in numbers that far exceeded any projections. The American Association of Colleges of Nursing website shows that there are 348 DNP programs in the United States currently enrolling students. There are another 98 in the planning stages. Internationally, Saudi Arabia, Hong Kong, and Ireland have established DNP programs. Canada is set to open 3 DNP programs in the near future. Many students attend DNP programs in the United States and return to their home country, including one of our co-authors who attended Case Western Reserve's DNP program and then returned to Canada. Many nurses like the idea of being researching professionals as opposed to professional researchers. In 2006, AACN endorsed the essentials of the doctoral education in advanced nursing practice. Two models of the degree were designed, a leadership track and a nurse practitioner track. The leadership track proved more popular with students. In a recent publication, Dr. Mary Mundinger of Columbia University estimated that 85% of DNP graduates graduated from the leadership track. It's clear that many DNP are teaching nursing. I am a volunteer peer evaluator with ACEN, one of the accrediting organizations in the United States. I have noticed when reviewing schools that DNP nurse faculty are present in great numbers. ACEN accredits schools across America. The schools that I've evaluated are not associated with large academic medical centers in urban areas. These are communities that need to train their own healthcare workforce because no one is moving there. These faculty are very important resources to their local community. Every school I reviewed had DNP faculty, at least one, many had four. Some schools, this non-scientific sample demonstrated that DNPs have already made a big impact on academia. It also validated the article based on AACN that 30% of DNP graduates teach in schools of nursing. There is a renewed interest in including teacher training content in master's and doctoral nursing programs. Post-master's certificate courses and inclusion of elective courses in doctoral programs are meeting an important need. And I'll hand it over to Emerson.
I would like now to address the third objective of this presentation by discussing nurse educator preparation and competencies outlined by AACN and NLN and the World Health Organization. Very briefly, the American Association of Colleges of Nursing represents 825 member schools of nursing at public and private universities in the US and works to establish quality standards for nursing education, influences the nursing profession to improve healthcare, and promotes public support for professional nursing education, research, and practice. The role of the DNP in nursing education has been addressed by AACN in its position statement published in 2004. Having a DNP would not only prepare clinical systems leaders, but would increase the supply of faculty for practice instruction. The AACN is also very clear that the DNP is a degree and not a role, and those who aspire to be nurse educators need additional training and education. In 2017, the National League for Nursing, another national organization for faculty nurses and leaders in nurse education in the US, released the position statement, Graduate Preparation for Academic Nurse Educators, which reinforced a former position statement that advocated for nurse educators to be prepared at the doctoral level, and I quote, to ensure that future nurses can practice competently in environments that demand the delivery of safe and cost-effective, systems-oriented, and team-driven care. This position statement has specific recommendations for the profession and the graduate programs of nursing in the US that include incorporating education-related coursework in doctoral program preparation and to double the number of faculty with formal graduate preparation in nursing education by year 2020. Education by competent and qualified nurse educators and to mitigating the shortage of doctorally prepared nurse educators. This is a very busy slide, but the information in the slide from NLN and AACN about highest earned credentials of full-time faculty of all ranks in the US may provide some insight. The first table on your left, if you're facing this stage, has data from 1984 to 2009. The middle table has this information in 2015, and the last table has this information for the year 2017. Focusing on doctoral doctorally prepared faculty at all ranks in the US, please look at the first table with a bar graph in green. You will notice that the rate slightly increase, it's not green, it's actually blue, but I'm colorblind, so it's the blue one. You will notice that the rate slightly increased from 1984 until 2002, but stayed stagnant in 2004 and 2008 at 25%. Moving to the middle table, note that this number went up in 2015 at 33% and continued to grow to 38% in 2017 as per the last table on your right. Noteworthy is the increase in the number of faculty at the assistant professor rank from 40% in 2015 to 46% in 2017. It is safe to assume that many are prepared SDNPs. As Dr. Rafferty discussed earlier, DNPs are assuming faculty roles, and there are data suggesting that DNPs are contributing to mitigating the shortage of doctorally prepared nurse educators, and they're growing in number. This is encouraging news for all, for sure, and support the need to integrate nurse education courses, either as elective or required courses or as tracks in DNP programs in the US and the growing DNP programs around the world. Thank you so much for your attention.
Anybody have any questions? Well, I have one. very interesting topic because I'm also from the United States and we have DNP programs at my university. The white paper that came out in 2015, I believe, that actually said that we should remove all of the educational courses or they can't do any mentorship with academia. Do you believe that has hurt us by preparing faculty, are they prepared for their faculty role? How do we battle that?
Right, so that 2015 position statement, the white paper, clarifying paper, was very important. But there's also a section in there that really was very important to really make sure that people understand that the DNP is not a role, it is a degree. Mm-hmm. And as someone who has a DNP or maybe someone who has a PhD, if you want to become an educator, then you need to pursue education and training to do that because education is a specialized field. Now think about this. So if you're a DNP faculty and you're educating future DNPs, would you want your DNP faculty to be aware and to really be immersed in curriculum and understand how curriculum works? Because you have to support students, you have to support programs, and you have to make sure that they meet program and student outcomes. So there's a lot of things that we have to think about the role of DNPs in nursing education. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, for our next presentation, I'd like to, the title is Identifying Patterns of Occupational Stress Trajectories Among Newly Graduated Nurses Using Group-Based Trajectory Modeling, a Longitudinal Study by Yuanyuan Zhang from China.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Sherry, for your introduction. So, I'm Yuanyuan Zhang from Shanghai Jiao Tong University School of Nursing, and it's a great honor to be here and share our study on behalf of our team. So today, the topic I wanted to share with all of you is identifying patterns of occupational stress trajectories among newly graduated nurses, a longitudinal study. So. Firstly, Shanghai Jiao Tong University is one of the universities which have been first approved to be bachelor, master, and a PhD degree referral spot in China. And our School of Nursing have ranked at number 5 and number 6 based on our national nursing discipline rankings in 2012 and 2016, respectively. So today, my presentation will have the following five sections. So first, background. Here in the figure, it presents the numbers of nursing staff in China from 2005. So obviously, it increased year by year. And it is estimated that by the year of 2020, we will have 4.45 million nurses in China, which means we will have more and more newly graduated nurses joining our big family. However, our new nurses will undergo a process of transition before they become a competent nurse, which I think most of you have heard of it many times for these days. So various of reasons have proposed, and such as nursing shortage, which leaves less time period for our new nurses to get familiar with their new role as an RN, and also overwhelming workload, unsupportive work environment, and a reality shock. All these factors are contributing to their high levels of occupational stress. And then, as we all know, if stress are not effectively managed, it will cause a lot of negative outcomes for our nurses themselves, the patients, and also the organizations. So a report in the United States have showed that there are 13% of new nurses will quit after 1 year. And then 37% of new nurses are ready to quit, change their employment or quit after within 2 and 3 years. And then while in China, our previous 1 year longitudinal study turns out that around 75% of newly graduated nurses have different levels of intention to leave at different time period during the first year of a transition. And the alarming rate of turnover related to occupational stress led to total costs ranging from $20,561 in the United States and $48,790 in Australia. So it is very important to help our new nurses to manage their occupational stress and to maintain our new nurses in the clinical settings. So most studies about occupational stress have focused on potential contributors, predictors of occupational stress at specific time period. And moreover, due to various personal, psychological, and cultural factors, each new nurses will react to stressors and using coping strategies heterogeneously. So, however, longitudinal data typically have been summarized as in terms of population averages as sequential time points. So, our study aimed at address these literature gaps by determining differences in occupational stress levels of newly graduated nurses at different time points during the first 3 years of practice, and then identifying potential subgroups of newly graduated nurses who perceive different occupational stress levels across these 3 years, and then evaluating differences in identified subgroups based on demographic characteristics. Next, let's move on to the methods. So we conducted a three-year longitudinal study from 2014 to 2017 and with annual in-person data collection. And 343 newly graduated nurses in four tertiary hospitals in Shanghai who met the inclusion criteria are invited to participate. So here's the flowchart of the sample size over time. At the last time point, which is 2017, we have 152 new nurses completed all the four data collections. So this group of new nurses are used for the further data analysis. And here in the figure, it shows mean level change across the 3 years of practice of occupational stress, which is the red solid line, and also the each observed individual trajectory of stress over time, which are the dashed lines. So according to the figure, we found that these nurses, they experience their occupational stress decreased to lowest after 2 years, and then they experience a slightly increase at the 3 year. So although the statistical differences was on occupational stress was identified over time, but the trajectory is relatively flat. So, and then the divergent distribution of individual trajectory also support that it could have distinct trajectories of newly graduated nurses. They can experience different patterns of trajectory. So then we conducted a group-based trajectory modeling, and according to model selection criteria, three different subgroups were identified, which were named as low occupational stress trajectory, medium trajectory, and high trajectory. So we need to figure out what kind of new nurses are preferred to experience high levels of occupational stress or relatively low, because that's essential for our further interventions and targeted interventions for our new nurses to reduce their occupational stress. So then we examined the differences of between the three identified subgroups based on their demographic characteristics. And according to the table, we found that in the low occupational stress subgroup, they had a higher proportion of nurses from Shanghai, and then the majority were employed as contract-based nurses. In comparison, the high occupational stress trajectory had the largest largest proportion of nurses from the provinces out of Shanghai. And then almost half of participants were employed as bianzhi nurses, and the majority reported to be assigned preceptor according to their shifts. So I think most of you are not familiar with bianzhi nurses in China. So in the Chinese employment system, they usually have two types of employment. For our nurses, they are bianzhi nurses and contract-based nurses. So bianzhi jobs are government-guaranteed positions with lifetime employment, and these nurses cannot be dismissed by their employers. And over the past two decades, Chinese hospitals have hired increasing number of contract-based nurses and reduced number of bianzhi nurses, which led to the traditional bianzhi positions are reserved for those nurses with better qualifications, such as with a bachelor or master's degree or have higher qualifications. So these nurses are usually were assigned with high demanding tasks in the clinical settings, which will contribute to their increased levels of occupational stress. So conclusions, according to our study, we found that newly graduated nurses in this study typically follow the trajectory of decreasing levels of occupational stress during the first 3 years. And these nurses, nurses who came from areas outside of Shanghai were employed as bianzhi nurses or were assigned multiple preceptors were more likely to experience high levels of occupational stress. So according to the findings, managers should identify and target at-risk newly graduated nurses and suggest more customized interventions to better manage their occupational stress. And lastly, I want to express my great thanks to my supervisor, Professor Zhang Yaqing, my co-supervisor, Dr. Lindsay Stege, and all my team members and all the administrative staff and newly graduated nurses who participate in this study. And based on our previous studies, we have developed a stress management intervention already. So here's the picture that we... on this on-site picture, and the nurses really enjoy our workshops. Lastly, nurses make the world a better place. So be nice to our new nurses. Thank you. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you so much. Any questions? I'm trying to look. Oh, there's a question. Can you get to the microphone or? Oh, I thought it was standing there earlier. Oh, there's one over here. Sorry, the lights are blinding. Oh, she's going to run that way. Okay.
This is Masako Kanai back from Japan, and thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. And work stress for the new grad is also the issue in Japan. My question is not related to the result. My question is that the two types of the nurses, you mentioned about the contract and then the other one, I cannot pronounce, but anyway. So contract nurse, how you can differentiate at the first place? You can apply for that, you know, how are you gonna differentiate, and then how, maybe, you know, like a test or anything? I don't know the system. Could you explore the system, please?
Thanks for your question. Because some time, limited time, so I just talk a little bit about it. So usually in China, when our new nurses, they recruited by the hospital, the hospitals can depend, like you are binge nurses or contract-based basic nurses according to your hometown, your degree, academic degree, and some other reasons. So for binge nurses, as I said, so they have a guarantee, lifetime guarantee, and maybe more stable salary, or although it's we have equal pay for equal work, is that the right quote? So it still have some differences for salaries or something. So usually in previous studies, contract-based nurses were found to experience higher occupational stress. But in our study, we found that binge nurses, which with lifetime guarantee, they have higher occupational stress. And the reason is just like I said. Yeah. Does it make sense for you?
Thank you. Just one quick question. Mm-hmm. If you want to get the lifetime, the contract one, you can apply for the lifetime status?
I have opportunity for you to take the exams or something. I'm not quite sure about that, but the hospitals will renew their contract 2 or 3 years. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So our next presentation is Sustaining the Rural and Remote Nursing Workforce Within Queensland, Australia, is by Shelley Nowlan and Michelle Ghana from Australia.
Good afternoon, everyone. The hard session after our breaks. My name's Shelley Nowlan, Chief Nurse and Midwifery Officer for Queensland, and joining me is Michelle Ghana, Executive Director of Nursing for one of our rural hospitals and health services. So this afternoon, we want to actually talk to you about the challenges that we have in Queensland in regards to providing our rural communities nursing services. We're fairly well challenged by the following points in regards to having our services resourced by both nurses and midwives. Aging workforce, our average age of our nurse in Queensland's around 55 years. We have geographical isolation where some of the communities are 2 hours to 3 hours driving distance from the facility that's in those rural hospitals and health services, and or only accessible by plane. We have professional isolation where some of the posts are single nurse posts, and in those towns may only be other auxiliary services such as teachers, police, and of course the communities that live in that rural regional area. Nurse safety is a big concern, and around attraction and retention of working in those isolated, professionally isolated and geographical isolation, nurse safety is a huge concern for us. Access to professional development is also another key factor that assists with attraction and retention. So for the size of Australia, we wanted to demonstrate that there's 27 countries here that overlay our country. Where we are situated is on the eastern side of the border. So as you look at the screen here on the left side is our state. And when you look at the size of that, we've got Chile, Finland, Belgium, Ireland, Austria, UK, Serbia, Italy, Netherlands, Ecuador and New Zealand covering part of our state. This is Queensland, and the coloured areas represent four of the hospital and health services that provide rural services to the community. In one area we'll have 500 nurses, the second column represents about 450 nurses, the next 400, and the final column 220. So we're not talking large numbers, but for those communities that they serve, they are absolutely integral and paramount to ensure that we have safe care and accessible care. The workforce demand and retirement, so the blue line there represents the demand on nursing services in those four areas that we class as rural. In Queensland, we actually have a surplus of nurses and midwives, but we have a maldistribution of where those nurses and midwives live to where their jobs are. So our jobs are in the rural areas. The other big issue is skill. So our presentation today really focuses on how we grow our own, how we attract our nurses and midwives to meet this gap between the blue and the red line that is looming in the next couple of years to 2025. We have a workforce program that's focused on career pathways, and the strategy around that is to ensure that there is access for early career nurses, so the novice to expert, and that we are focused on our future need, but also having the philosophy that those nurses and midwives are focused on their own unique needs and that they grow their future careers. It's about developing confidence, ensuring that there is autonomy to practice and to work to their full scope of practice. So with that, we've developed out of the Office of Chief Nurse and Midwifery Officer in Queensland, the Queensland Health Framework for Lifelong Learning. And we work collaboratively with Metro North Hospital and Health Services, which is one of our biggest hospitals and health services in Queensland, to ensure that we had a career path that was suitable for nurses, that it matched the job descriptions that they would work in, that there was significant orientation to their role, first and foremost, most of entering into the workforce, that there was also extended capacity to ensure that we had a performance development review that supported the development of the individual nurse and or midwife, and that there was recognition of prior learning of their areas of specialty.
Thank you, sir. I'm Michelle Garner, and I'm the Executive Director of Nursing and Midwifery for Northwest Hospital and Health Service. So you did see Shelley's map. The health service that I manage is just under the size of Malaysia, and there are 32,000 people. So it is an extremely isolated part of Australia and quite challenging. And as you can imagine, as a registered nurse or midwife, coming into some of those areas is quite challenging. So in this last financial year, the Office of the Chief Nurse, Shelley being our Chief Nurse, put out a call for one of the remote health services to sponsor what would look like a rural generalist program, and how that would start to prepare nurses to come and work in some of these most remote and isolated areas and be prepared. So the brief really was to be able to pulled together a program, I suppose, that looked at all levels of nursing, our novice to expert, and nurses that would be able to come into rural and remote areas at any point in their career. So whether it be when they're just finished their undergraduate training and are a postgraduate, or some of the nurses may have been 5 or 10 years out and decided that they would like to come and do a stint in rural and remote areas. And so how is it that you prepare yourself to come into those areas? We've seen many an emergency department nurse come in from a big tertiary facility who thought that their skill or their expertise level was preparing them to come to rural and remote, and that actually wasn't the case. So it was about pulling together a program. So in the onset of doing that, we actually looked and thought we really need to do an environmental scan of what was going on around not only Queensland but Australia and the world as to how we could start to think about what this Rural Generals program would look like. So we looked at legislation, we looked at some of the literature, we looked at some of the programs that were provided out of the university sector in Queensland, but also within the university sector, some of our professional organisations. And for Queensland, because our area is so big for rural and remote provision of healthcare, we do have a number of areas that already support nurses and midwives to be able to move into those areas. So what programs did they already have that existed that we could pull together that people could access to prepare them to come and work? So we have a group called the Rural and Remote Clinical Workforce, which is a group of all professions that come together that look at rural and remote. Now, for our medical workforce in Queensland, we already have a rural generalist medical workforce, and we also have, which has a particular program, and we also have a rural allied health. So sort of to come in line with our mates, we thought that we probably needed to move in that direction of the rural generalist for nursing. And we pulled together a heap of nurses who already work in that arena. And these are just some of the big words that they sort of pulled together that they thought really was what described rural and remote nursing. I won't read it out. I'm sure you've all had a time to see the highlighted areas. But that's essentially what the nurses of Queensland believe is rural and remote nursing, or what is a rural generalist. I suppose one of the big parts of being a rural generalist is to understand what is your community of practice and what is the context of practice. So we all think of rural and remote and we might sort of think in the general state, but in actual fact in Queensland it's not that simple. So it's really about preparing the nurse to be able to go into what is the community of practice that they're entering. So we have large Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities. We have small Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities. We have big farming isolated communities. We have a lot of communities in rural and remote Queensland that aren't necessarily three generational, and that the workforce is very transient. So government tends to provide a lot of the people who are local, which of course quite often don't end up to be three generational. So the workforce becomes very transitional. So it's about being work ready to go into what is that context of community of practice. So I suppose I've probably talked about this slide already, but yeah, it's really about, you know, having a familiarity of task and what it is to be expected of that of a rural and remote generalist nursing, and you know, what is your performance dependent on. So we developed, after having all looked at everything that we needed to look at, we have developed a rural generalist pathway. And again, the rural generalist pathway is will be accessible through the Office of the Chief Nurse, and it will guide nurses at any point in their career and guide them through different methods of learning and preparation to prepare them to be able to go into community of practice where they would like to work within rural and remote settings. So we sort of looked at two main programs, an immersion program, and there was a talk somewhere else today about, or from a Queensland context, about an immersion program for intensive care. So we've sort of stolen that little idea and we've done sort of an immersion program into rural and remote. And it really is a 3 to 6 month quick immersion program, putting nurses into the firing line and being able to go through some of those quick learning modules to prepare them very quickly to work in rural and remote. And of course then there's a transition program, which is a much longer, more sustained period for those nurses particularly that want to stay within that rural and remote context and be able to go through formal programs which are transitional but also start to look at postgraduate education. So the considerations moving forward, and this is not finished as yet, so to create some rural generalist positions within our rural and remote workforce, start looking at the hospital and health service agreements that they have within Queensland Health, which is the agreement of how we are funded, and to look at how do we modify our positions. So grade 5 to grade 8 really is our base grade registered nurse through to our nurse practitioners in rural and remote, and how do we support transition through all those levels. And how do we also make this program so that it has some credit towards universities? And that's about it. And I'll hand over to Shelley because she wants to do a bit of a plug on something else.
So given Australia is well known for their rural regional care, I have joined the Global Doctors in regards to promoting rural remote health. And I just want to call to arms this conference, Wonka World Rural Health Conference. It's in New Mexico in October, and it will be the first time that we will have a nurse as a keynote speaker and a workshop looking at how nurses can be elevated by doctors and supported in the aim to have universal health coverage. So take a look at that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, we won't be having any more questions due to the timing. We will have them at individual presenters at the end. So I would like to introduce our next one. It is, the title is The Association of Acculturation and Complementary Infant and Young Children Feeding Practices Among New Chinese Immigrant Mothers in England, a Mixed Methods. And it is by Soning Zhang from China.
It's my honor to be here to have this presentation, and my topic is the association of acculturation and complementary infant and young children feeding practices amongst the new Chinese immigrant mothers in England, a mixed methods. Establishing healthy dietary beliefs and behaviors in early life is an important health strategy to combat childhood overweight and obesity. Complementary feeding is defined as the introduction of solid and semi-solid foods along with breast. The target range of CF is 6 to 23 months of age, with the purpose of developing infant and young child dietary beliefs and behaviors. Infant and young child feeding practices have been identified as an important under-prioritized strategy for early prevention of childhood obesity and to foster lifelong health. IFCF is a key determinant not only of nutritional intake of children, but also the way food is offered or administered, which is influenced by a number of cultural and social factors. So cultural diversity is a typical characteristic of many countries, while race and ethnicity are recognized determinants of health inequalities in urban populations. To address health inequalities, it's important to consider how social cultural differences influence minority populations. There were 724,000 live births by a large number of births to non-UK-born women. The total fertility rate was 1.84 for UK-born women and 2.21 for non-UK-born women. So London was the region with the largest number of migrants, and China was in the top three nationalities of non-EU citizens. So Chinese in the UK are often referred to be a homogeneous group. There are a variety of nationalities and cultural groups that fall under the label Chinese and a lack of clarity surrounding the label make the group an example of the complexities of ethnicities and culture. Health inequalities have also been demonstrated through the empirical evidence of the underutilization of social and health services by Chinese populations. Language gaps and literacy is one explanation offered for Chinese populations. Culture and individual characteristics, as well as knowledge, beliefs, and attitudes have important influences on the perceived behavior of mothers of different ethnicities. Cultural dietary preferences and eating beliefs that shape dietary choices. So IYCF is influenced by culture-specific beliefs. The prevalence of obesity in Chinese-American children is lower than prevalence in other ethnic groups. They are recognized to be quite complex and have been identified in other ethnic groups. So there is a lack of data in existence on cultural influences on IFCF in minorities. So complementary feeding has been identified as an important and under-prioritized strategy to prevent childhood obesity. There is a wide in-house policies on optimal culturally tailoring IFCF in Chinese immigrants. To bridge this gap, the aims of this mixed study were to explore how acculturation has influenced complementary feeding practices to improve and enrich this area of research in order to provide evidence to hopefully design an intervention to link health services and facilities with Asian communities. Study design, this research used questionnaire surveys and semi-structured interviews. We integrated qualitative and quantitative components to explore cultural influences on beliefs of IYCF. It can be challenging to access research participants from Chinese populations. So snowball and purposive sampling were used. Participants were recruited through informal community organizations. These are inclusion and exclusion criteria. We measure the basic demographic information. The infant feeding style questionnaire was utilized to investigate IIBCF. Cultural influences as well as individual health beliefs and behaviors played important roles in IFCF practices of the mothers. So this study was the first mixed study to our knowledge to describe the current IYCF beliefs among new Chinese immigrant mothers in the UK and explore the cultural influences on IYCF practices. The beliefs of pricing restrictive and responsive were described highly among Chinese immigrants. Restricting unhealthy foods by preventing the access to and limiting the amount consumed was a general strategy to improve infant diet or reduce the risk of weight gain. Some Chinese immigrant mothers strictly followed the advice of health professionals. So these mothers believed British health beliefs and abandoned Chinese health beliefs and fading beliefs or behaviors. So more than half of the mothers believe that their toddler should finish all food on their plate. They pressured their toddler to eat a certain quantity through the use of a food bowl. New Chinese immigrant mothers need culturally appropriate health policies of optimal IVCF. Challenges arising from the differences between British and Chinese health beliefs and the traditional culture, in addition to the differences between home culture and the dominant society. Promoting optimal IVCF in new Chinese immigrant groups need health strategies to reconcile the differences between the perception of British and Chinese health beliefs and the traditional culture. So new Chinese immigrant mothers reported positive IVCF beliefs. The first restrictive amount and diet quality, encouragement in engagement in lowly indulgence and highly responsive to advocate light food and healthy dietary beliefs. They balance information sources and cultural preferences. The new Chinese immigrant mothers reported the barriers of IVCF beliefs. They first introduced the solid food earlier than NHS guide. Language difficulties and cultural influences to access health services. Our initial evidence demonstrates that a participatory approach, including peer support, which the mothers currently used, would be an ideal strategy. The ultimate goal was to achieve culturally supporting health policies of IVCF. Studies exploring the views of British and minority health beliefs and the traditional culture are warranted to ensure optimal IVCF practice in minority populations. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, our next presentation is by Sue Affairs from Lebanon, and she is going to speak about continuing nursing education of registered nurses and nurse managers, perceptions, priorities, and barriers. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So today I'll be presenting like a small part of two national projects that were led in Lebanon on the continuing nursing education of nurses and nurse managers. The lead PI on this project is Dr. Norhayah Bikdoumet, my colleague, and the work was supported by our institution, the American University of Beirut, with the in-kind support of the Order of Nurses, and special thanks to Mrs. Natalie Risha, the director of the order. So nursing professional development builds on basic and continuing education needs for the best quality of care of the patient. And although registered nurses and nurse managers remain ultimately responsible for their ongoing professional development, however, it is them that should, they would be better involved in the CNE offerings if it is them that they perceive the need to pursue CNE offerings. Thus, their participation in CNE offerings is affected by several factors, including their perceptions, but also including the priorities of the topics of the sessions to be offered and the barriers that keep them from attending such sessions. Now, a quick overview of the nursing profession in Lebanon. So, the Order of Nurses in Lebanon is the sole regulator of the nursing practice. The nursing practice was legislated in 1979, and the standards of care were established in 2009. Now, some challenges. First, we don't have up to this moment, we did not have mandatory CNE. However, while we were present in this conference, the government has passed the legislation that CNE should be mandatory for nurses. We have also the accessibility and affordability, like centralization of CNE offerings and other challenges. Thus, the objectives of this presentation are to identify the perceptions towards CNE among RNs and nurse managers and compare between the two groups. Also, identify and compare the priorities of the topics between the two RNs and nurse managers and the barriers toward pursuing and attending CNE sessions. Now, as I said in the beginning, we are basing our results on two national studies. First, on the registered nurses study. This was a multi-center cross-sectional study that included a sample of 61 hospitals. 6,000 questionnaires were distributed to RNs with a response rate of RNs at 61%. We got around 3,500 RNs responding. For the nurse manager study, we followed the same design. However, we had more hospitals that we approached, like 117, and we had a higher response rate for RNs, like 74% out of the 1,500 questionnaires that were distributed. Now, a quick overview of the hospitals in Lebanon. We had 150 hospitals. Of these, 101 hospitals accredited. And the way they were distributed across governorates, we had in Beirut, the capital, around 11%. We have the majority in Mount Lebanon, like around 38%. And in the other rural areas like Tripoli, Bekaa, and South, around 17%. For our RN study, we actually respected this quota, was respected, like as we see in Beirut, we had a 10%, and the majority, 36% in Mount Lebanon. Same for the nurse managers, that's how the hospitals were, the recruited hospitals were distributed, around 13% in Beirut, and another majority of 37% in Mount Lebanon. Now, our two studies were based on this model, the continuing professional development cycle and system adapted from Moore et al. But today I'll be presenting only on the assessment component. It's how can patient care quality improve and needs assessment. Our samples were mostly females, 77% for the RNs and 84% for the nurse managers. And for the RNs, the majority were in the 20 to 29-year-old group age category, and the nurse managers were in the 30 to 39 age category. The majority of both groups were married. As for the income, I mean, as expected, they differed. The RNs reported earning less than $1,000 as a monthly income as compared to nurse managers who reported earning more than $1,000 as a monthly income. Education also was, differed. It's technical and vocational were the majority of RNs, a technical degree, whereas the nurse manager had a BS degree in nursing. And the majority of the participants, like the hospitals, they came from the Mount Lebanon. Now, first, we asked the participants whether they had taken, they were engaged in previously CNE sessions, and we see that more of the nurse managers reported attending, like around 80%, as compared to 60% only of RNs reported attending previously a CNE session. So we moved then to collecting data on their perceptions using a series of questions. First of them, for example, are you interested in attending CNE? Because this is where we should start. And we found that a great majority, almost everybody, like in the more than 95% of both groups, reported their interest in attending CNE sessions. Then we asked them whether they think that these sessions should be free of charge. We found, as you see, the blue column, it's a much higher percentage of the RNs as compared to nurse managers reported that they expect these offerings to be free of charge. Moving on with the perceptions, we asked them about how they prefer the sessions to be, the institutional approach, starting with the method. So do they prefer a discussion? Do they prefer a workshop? Do they prefer a skills lab, case study, lecture, etc.? And we see here that the majority of the nurse managers preferred like workshop. This was the most preferred among managers. But among RNs, they were more like a lecture and a discussion. But both groups preferred less a skills lab or a case study. We also ask them, where do you prefer these sessions to take place? Is it close to your work, close to your residence, or close to, at actually the Order of Nurses headquarters? And both groups, a high majority, as you see, preferred the close to work. With, if you look at the nurse managers, okay, they preferred a little bit more close to residence or in the order headquarters of the order, but the big majority of both groups, it's convenient to them to have it close to their work. Another thing, we ask them the format. Is it small groups of 20 participants or less? Is it 21 to 30 or big groups of more than 30? And as we see here, the dominance was, as we expected, also for small groups as compared to larger groups in both nurse managers and RNs. Moreover, we ask them still about their perception regarding how many days they prefer the sessions to be. Is it half a day, one full day, or more than a day? Again, as we expect, because of the high workload the nurses are subject to, they preferred half a day. The nurse managers were fine, a little bit more fine with one full day, but again, the majority of both groups, they preferred half a day sessions. Now we move to the barriers. The way we collected barriers is actually we asked both groups in the questionnaire to list the barriers that prevent them from seeking and attending CNE. Not everybody responded to this because we have a much higher samples than these two, but because it was an open-ended questions, only 1,789 RNs responded and 793 nurse managers responded. So these were open-ended questions. And later we looked and analyzed these answers, and we found that they fall under three groups: personal reasons, reasons related to work, or some reasons related to the CNE sessions themselves. I give just examples. So for personal, for example, they reported family, stress, age, personal life, etc. For work-related, work overload, number of employees, no follow-up from the medical institution, and the like. For CNE sessions related, so the cost of the session, the place and time of the session, the fees, again, back to the cost, long duration, etc. So when we saw the three groupings among RNs, the 1, 2, 3, the ranking, we found that the RNs, the majority, around 60%, reported the main reason was related to their work, and then followed by the CNE sessions themselves, how they are held, and last was the personal. It wasn't the case with the managers. The manager, the first, around 80% of the managers had personal reasons as the first barrier to keep them from seeking CNE, followed by the sessions themselves, and the last was related to work. Then we moved to priorities, and priorities were also like the barriers, open-ended questions about list the three priorities that you would like to have a CNE session in. Again, not everybody responded. We have around 3,000 RNs and 700 nurse managers to respond to these questions. The top four priorities of RNs were life support, 13%, respiratory and cardiac, 12%, and gastrointestinal subjects, 11%. For the nurse managers, definitely they were different. They were about management, 62% functions of management, 43% quality management process, 30% leadership, and 27% communication. Now, before I continue, I have here to mention that for the RN's study, we had another question about priorities where we added, do you want to have a CNE session in technical skills, in etc. So we had the topic for them, and they had to say yes or no. However, this is not what I am presenting here. So as a summary, we see that a higher proportion of nurse managers reported attending CNE, which is expected, like 78% as compared to 62%. The vast majority of both groups, the very vast majority, expressed their interest in attending CNE sessions, which is very encouraging. RNs believed that the sessions should be free of charge, but less so did the nurse managers. The instructional approaches were similar in both groups in terms for both opting for half-a-day session, sessions of a small number of participants, and close to their work. And the workshops format were preferred more among nurse managers as compared to RNs. Now, in terms of priorities, nurse managers listed their priorities as, again, management functions, quality management, leadership, skills communication, whereas the priorities of RNs were many, were actually mostly related to patient care, life support, respiratory, cardiac, and gastrointestinal. The barriers listed by both groups fell into the same three categories, although in different proportions, but they were personal, related to their work, or related to the CNE sessions themselves. So we know that nurse managers have more access to CNE activities, and they could afford the expenses more than bedside nurses. However, based on the study, both nurses indicated their approaches and they indicated their priorities, etc. Now, what these national studies helped in? They helped, first of all, identify and compare whatever I presented, the perceptions, barriers, and priorities of CNE among RNs and nurse managers. But more importantly, they set the background for designing CNE for Lebanese nurses, where nurses and hospital administrations take into consideration the perspectives of RNs and nurse managers when planning a CNE offering for them. Now, these two studies, they helped designing a national capacity building program of nurses and nurse managers. The program for nurses already launched and phase one completed. And here we see our minister when the launch happened and our former president of the order. Phase one completed, phase two about to start. And for nurse managers, they will start soon. Thank you.
Okay, for our next presentation, it is Mio Hosanna from Japan, and she's going to be talking about the effects of electronic media use on sleep quality and fatigue among shift work nurses, analysis using actigraphy.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Mio Hosanna. I belong to Kobe University in Japan. I feel pleased to have this chance to speak to you. Previous studies showed that night shift calls nurses heavy tiredness and stress. Shift work nurses get out of shape on circadian rhythm, so they have a higher risk of coronary heart disease, breast cancer, and material cancer, and so on. Effects of health related to using electronic media for adolescents were showed on life satisfaction, communication with family, obesity, mental problems, and insomnia. If the bright at daytime affect sleep quality on shift work nurses, they go on working without recovery from heavy tiredness. In Japan, the pattern of shift work was two shift work or three shift work. Two shift work is a common shift now. In two shift work, nurses work in daytime for 8 hours from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. And nurses work in night shift for 16 hours from 4 p.m. to 8:30 a.m. with a break and between resting for 2 or 3 hours. The purpose of this study was to investigate the effects of electronic media use on sleep quality and fatigue measured using acculturation among two shift work nurses. Methods. The design of this study was a randomized controlled trial. Participants were 20 nurses who worked for two shifts in an advanced treatment hospital in Japan. We randomly assigned participants to two groups. The acculturation was used. Time spent asleep, time taken to fall asleep. The first group that used electronic devices such as a cell phone or smartphone, a tablet, a computer or laptop, a game machine before going to bed, and the second group that did not. Measures. The acculturation was used, time spent asleep, time taken to fall asleep, and the number of times the participants awakened at night. Additionally, a visual analog scale was measured sleep satisfaction, sense of sleeping well, and fatigue level. Results. This is characteristics in participants. Mean of age in group 1 was 36.7 years, and group 2 was 33.7 years. Participants of each group used the longest hours, a cell phone or smartphone for a day. This graph shows results on comparison with time spent asleep using acculturation. No significant differences in time spent asleep, time to fall asleep, and the number of times awaken at night using acculturation were observed between two groups. This is the result of the comparison with luminance, change of satisfaction of sleep, and fatigue level. The change of those was calculated. The group who used the electronic media before going to bed significantly scored lower on luminance than another group who did not use electronic media. The score of sleep quality and fatigue level tended to low in using electronic media group. That's all I show results about comparison sleep quality and fatigue level between two groups. Now we'll move on to result of analysis of individual data on acculturation among all 20 participants. So we mainly found four characteristics of the data. This was the data for 3 days, including night shift. Light blue line showed sleep time, and the blue arrow showed waking time in the night shift, and the black waveform showed waking time and activity amount. The yellow waveform showed luminance level. Nurses on two-shift work usually took a break in the night shift. Night shift started from 4 p.m. And five nurses, 20% nurses of all participants, woke up later than 12 a.m. without taking a nap. This is the case of nurse 2. 16 nurses, 18 nurses of all participants woke up later than 9 a.m. on the day of night shift. This is the case of nurse 3. This nurse took a break before midnight in a night shift. The nurse had a break in early time of the night shift. This nurse did not have a sleeping timer in a night shift. In addition, she had not slept for about 24 hours, including a night shift. Discussion. To use electronic media for an hour before going to bed did not significantly affect sleep quality and fatigue level among shift work nurses in Japan. However, the score of sleep quality and fatigue tend to low in using electronic media group. In addition, we are not able to collect enough number of participants necessary for a stable outcome. More participants of data were needed for this type of statistical calculation. Oh, sorry. In Japan, the nurses of two-shift work worked in a night shift for 16 hours in Japan. The individual data of acculturation showed almost the participants woke up after 9 a.m. in the morning of a night shift and started to work in a night shift without a nap. On the other hand, nurses can't take enough break since patient's condition will take a sudden turn for the worse. Furthermore, the nurses may include to feel sleepy and have much fatigue. Due to preventing medical accidents, it is suggested that we make the system of nurses can take enough break at any time in the night shift. In conclusion, we showed that to use electronic media before going to bed did not associate with sleep quality and fatigue among shift work nurses in Japan. However, the score of sleep quality and fatigue tend to low in using electronic media group. In addition, almost all participants woke up around 9 to 12 a.m. in the morning, the day of the night shift, and started to work in a night shift without a nap. Thank you for kind attention.
Okay, our last presenter is here. His name is George Christakis from Greece. I know I didn't say that right. That's okay. And I'm going to let you introduce your presentation.
Yes, thank you. I will try to be as fast as possible. Okay, we are going to present the psychometric validation of the working extrinsic and intrinsic motivation scale in Greece. And it is important to do cross-validation comparisons because if we have common tools, then we will be able to be more specific and more precise when we compare what works and what doesn't work. So this was our aim to validate this scale in Greece. Why did we choose this scale? Because it is based on a theory, the self-determination theory. I'm going to explain it later. And it has been extensively used in different settings. And it also has adequate psychometric validities. So what does the self-determination theory says? It states that everyone has three inherent psychological needs that must be met. The first one is the autonomy, the need to feel in charge of their own actions. The second one is the competence, that we must feel that we have the ability to perform the tasks. And the third one is the relatedness, that we must be part of a group. We did the validation in the University Hospital of Heraklion, Crete, in a total sample of 258 participants with a response rate of 88%. Now, the VAMES, the scale, consists of six subscales. The first one is about the intrinsic motivation, saying that, for example, I derive much pleasure from learning new things. The second one is the integrated regulation, that I do this work because it is a part of my life. The third subscale is the identified regulation, because I choose this type of work to attain my career goals. And I'm not going to go through the others, you know, for the time reasons. We did everything that it is needed for the translation and the cultural adaptation, and we also did a test-retest study at the beginning, and all the necessary statistical analysis. We also secured the necessary ethical approval. Now, what are the results? For the main thing, that the exploratory factor analysis revealed that in Greece it has the same construction as in the other countries of the world. Now, something that it is very important, the highest rated items in Greece at least were the internal motivation item, because I derive much pleasure from learning new things. This is in a scale of 5. The same exactly value score was for the item for the satisfaction I experience when I am successful at doing difficult tasks. And the third highest rated item was the unmotivational factor. I don't know, too much is expected for us. And now I think that in this slide, we can experience what we experience in everyday clinical practice, that we like what we do, but then we have a lot of things to do and we get burnt out in a way. The lowest rated items in our sample was the external motivation, because this type of work provides me with security. Why do you do this work? Because this type of work I choose to do to attain a certain lifestyle. And the third one, the lowest rated, was I ask myself this question: I don't seem to be able to manage the important tasks related to this work. So, the version of VIMES in Greece is a reliable and valid tool to measure the motivation of nurses in Greece and in Cyprus in Greek languages, and according to the self-motivation theory. We must have in mind that the results may be culture and context specific. And of course, the limitations are that we used only one institution, but the work conditions in Greece are more or less the same, because we are a public healthcare system and the salary, for example, is the same all over Greece. And the self-reported data are always prone to social desirability bias. Thank you very much. And I was a bit, you know, in a hurry. Thank you.
I apologize for the timing, and thank you. Does anybody have any questions? The presenters are still here, and they could be answering them afterwards, but I do know there's another session coming in here. So at this point, I wanted to thank everybody, and this concludes the session. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Takashi Owe, Department of Nursing, Faculty of Nursing, Hyogo University, Japan. I will be chairman in this session. I welcome at the ICN 2019, which organized around the theme of work environment. We have 8 presentations of all what in this session. Each speaker has 10 minutes per presentation, including question and answer section. Okay, first presentation is about the paper entitled the Association Between Nurses' Education and the Risk of Mortality of Fatality to Rescue in Acute Care Hospital. Okay, first presenter here? No? Okay, first presenter is canceled. Okay, next one. Next presentation is nurse and midwives scale up early infant male circumstance service in Rwanda. Here? No? No. Okay. Okay, yes. Our next one, please. Next presentation is visualizing comprising of nursing in humanitarian setting using self-administration electronic data collection performance to predict safety safe staffing relations. I would like to welcome to stage.
Thank you. Great. Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. Hands up if you've ever felt your contribution as a nurse was invisible. I know I have. My purpose is to lift the invisibility cloak currently shrouding our work and our contribution. And the way in which we can do that is to visualize it. Nurses deliver 80% of healthcare worldwide and are considered the largest untapped potential for improving quality in healthcare. Despite this, our role and our contributions are not seen or fully understood. With decisions about policy and management being made based on experience and opinion rather than evidence. But what is nursing? And in particular, what is nursing in a humanitarian setting? When most people think of nursing, they think of this. And being with the patient at their bedside is a large and important part of what we do. But there's so much more. And it's currently that more that is shrouded by the invisibility cloak. Take a second to think about what more is to you. For me, it's checking the resuscitation trolley. It's taking a patient for imaging so they get the best diagnosis. It's running down to the pharmacy to get a patient's take-home medications. How do we collect this data? How do we go about pulling off the invisibility cloak? We've all heard the excuses. Nursing is complex. It varies on a day-to-day and patient-to-patient basis. How can we collect the evidence needed to visualize our contribution and outline what that more is? The solution is apparently like everything these days. You get an app. So that's what we, Médecins Sans Frontières, did. We developed an app using ComCare, an electronic data collection platform, to capture every task nurses were conducting on the ward, as well as the time it took them to conduct them. But how feasible is it to actually use an app to collect this data? will the nurses be willing to use an app? And even if they are, what's the reality of them using it on the ward? These are the questions our feasibility study set out to answer. To understand if we could use an app to collect the data, the evidence needed to visualize nurses' contributions in humanitarian settings. Here are the methods, and let me tell you more. The data collection took place over a 6-week period with a 2-week pilot and a 4-week rollout in 2 pediatric wards of the MSF Kuntapalong Hospital, Cox Bazar, Bangladesh. And sampling was purposive and voluntary. The app included 56 tasks. This included the obvious ones, such as taking vital signs and administering medication, and the less obvious ones, but equally as important, such as cleaning biomedical equipment and surveillance. Surveillance is a really good example of an invisible nursing task. While some frustratingly think we're daydreaming at the nursing station, we're often observing the ward as a whole. Now, as we know, nursing is often about conducting tasks simultaneously, only starting one task, only to be called away in the middle to do another. To acknowledge this, at the end of each task, the app asked nurses 4 questions. Had they required assistance? Had they needed to leave the ward? Had they been interrupted? And had they actually managed to fully complete their task? Alongside this information, nurses also collected shift demographics, including the number of patients, nurses, and doctors on the ward and the patient acuity levels. To add a human element to the app, we added a HR tool to reveal nurses' qualifications and experience, and to help us better understand the tasks they were conducting and how long it took them to conduct them. While the nurses were using their app to unveil invisible tasks, I have my own data feed to kind of add a level of reality. As we know, not all wards are created equal. Resources available to one nurse may not be available to another. And this is really important to understand, especially in a humanitarian setting. So my data feed enabled me to get a holistic view of the environment in which nurses were working. Additionally, it enabled me to observe the extent to which nurses were following the MSF nursing guidelines. And suddenly, I've gone from being a technophobe to a techno-geek. How cool is technology? I'm sure some of you are thinking, though, will the nurses really have time to fit using an app in their already jam-packed schedule? We thought the same. But not only were they willing and able, but they were exhilarated by it. We recruited 100% of our sample target purely for the fact that they felt visible. The nurses were trained on the app and over the 2-week pilot familiarized themselves with using it on the ward. We worked together to make sure we captured all their tasks in the easiest way. And we ended up making 49 changes to the app before we rolled it out. But most importantly, what the pilot showed us was that using the app on the ward didn't take away or change or affect any of the nursing care being delivered. So, the results. They were extraordinary, beyond our expectations. The nurses logged over 6,000 tasks. That accounted for 76% of the time that nurses were on the ward over the 56 shifts, the 4-week rollout. So what was the other 24%, I hear you ask? Well, that consisted of events such as resuscitation when the app was not used, and times when the nurse simply forgot or was too busy to use the app. But had we managed to collect everything, had we managed to cover all the nursing tasks? To assess this, we looked at the number of others that had been logged. Others was where nurses could describe the task they were conducting as they hadn't been able to find it in the app. The total number of others logged was only 1%. highlighting that during our pilot, working with the nurses had enabled us to ensure that we were capturing close to every task they were conducting. But now the question was our data valid? Would cleaning our data show that we hadn't been as successful as we thought? Each task logged was linked to a ward, a shift, and a patient acuity number. And out of the 6,084 tasks logged, only 5 couldn't be linked to these 3 pieces of information. These were excluded, along with outliers. Outliers were times logged with a time duration that was clearly below or exceeding a reasonable amount. For example, a bedside handover that was logged as taking 12 hours, simply because the nurse had forgotten to complete the task and log out of the app. Or a ward round that took a matter of seconds, just because the nurse had accidentally pushed on the wrong task. Once these outliers had been removed, we were left with 95% of our data for our final analysis, part of which can be seen on the MSF booth in C1 on the poster. Like all studies, we had limitations. Obviously, the nurses could have logged tasks that they weren't conducting, or they could have changed their behavior during the study to fit what they felt was reasonable. And obviously, these results aren't generalizable, but they are possibly transferable to similar settings. This study is the first of its kind, and the data collected is on an equal scale to similar studies conducted in high-income settings. And what it shows us is an app can do it. An app can enable us to collect complex nursing data. An app can help us to visualize nurses' contributions in humanitarian settings. And an app can start to provide us with the data and the evidence we need to start basing our management and policy decisions on. But we mustn't forget that behind every good app, there's an even better team. And so I'd like to thank everybody involved in the study, but with a special thanks going out to the MSF Kuntapalong and Bangladesh teams, because without their enthusiasm and dedication, this wouldn't have been such a success. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Do you have any question or comment? Okay, please.
So I don't know if you heard the question, but it was, how does this work? How will this work help our communities and benefit our beneficiaries and the patients? Well, I think one of the biggest things is that we didn't really know what nursing in a humanitarian setting consisted of. So now we have an app that and data that consists of all the different tasks they were doing. In the results, we can see the amount of direct and indirect care they were doing. And for example, across the wards, you can see that the pattern is the same between the under 5 ward and the over 5 ward. Even though on the under 5 ward, the patient acuity level and the patient numbers were higher. So it's very task-orientated nursing. So this we can see this. But what we want to do is analyze. We've only just started analyzing the data, but we want to analyze it thoroughly to see whether we need to change the tasks nurses are doing, how they're doing, how long it's taking them to do them. For example, a lot of the nurses in Bangladesh do pharmacy tasks. And so, you know, and they took up a large amount of their time. So do we need to change that? Do we need someone else to be doing those pharmacy tasks? So hopefully what we can do, and the benefit that this will have, is we'll see what nursing really consists of. And hopefully we can ensure that the majority of the time is spent with the patient and that it's patient orientated. Thank you. Sure. Oh.
Thank you. as an old nurse, and the emphasis is on old, I really appreciated it, because what is happening is that the young nurses and the doctors and whoever else, they're on their phones a lot. And we, the older ones who don't know how to use the phones, I think we're a little jealous. And we fret and say, these young people are not doing nursing, they're just using their phones. What you have suggested, and perhaps you didn't intend this, but my old brain is picking this up, that perhaps we can now convert their phones into using something that's applicable to nursing that will help relieve some of the stress. The nurses will be using the tool they want. I mean, they might text a little boyfriend in between, but you know, that will be the main focus. But they will then be able to pick up information, and it then tells us what are the things that are vital for nursing. Caution though, don't get rid of the things that you are accustomed doing. Don't give them up. And my reason for saying this, I said to you, I'm old. And I lived in Britain for years, and there was a time in our lives in Britain when we were complaining that we were doing a lot of non-nursing things. And our good friend Maggie Thatcher said, vote for me and we'll look at what you're doing. And then we were so happy, and we all went along and put our ex where we, now I feel we shouldn't have, but we did. And she, when it was finished, she said, I said I would look at them. I didn't say I would do anything about them. So be very careful about getting rid of some of the things that seem like non-nursing, because they all contribute to the nurse, to the patient's health and well-being and welfare. And they may then bring non-nursing personnel into those areas who then think they have the right to dictate to nurses. Be warned.
Yeah. Thank you. I think that's a really good point. And what I hope is that this data set can be used by, you know, managers in looking at what the nurses are doing, and then together with the team they can make decisions. So hopefully it's providing that evidence base.
My question, the app collected what the nurses did do. Were you able to then say with the teams what they weren't doing because they were overwhelmed with patient numbers or tasks to do?
Yeah. So we actually added an element in where we asked nurses at the end of each shift anything that they hadn't been able to do. So we were looking for missed care. So anything that they hadn't been able to do on time or anything that they hadn't managed to do in the shift. And actually, the nurses didn't really fully understand the concept of missed care. And they very much liked to have done everything, which generally they did. But the other thing that we saw were the tasks that, for example, when I developed the app, I'd included that weren't done. For example, in Bangladesh, there's caretakers. And so you have a caretaker with every patient who stays with that patient throughout their time in hospital, and they do a large amount of what in the UK I would be doing. So they wash, dress, toilet, mobilize, feed, they do all of that. And so actually the Bangladeshi nurses didn't get so involved in that side of care, but that's because they didn't have to. So yeah, there were certain tasks we saw that weren't necessarily part of the usual Bangladeshi nursing day-to-day. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm sorry, time is almost up. So I would like to move on to next speaker. I would like to exchange the number presenters. So next presenter is a nurse and midwife scale up early impact male circumstance service in Rwanda. Okay, yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, nurses, colleagues, and the friends, midwives.
Good afternoon. This is my greater pleasure to be with you in this 2019 ICN Congress. I am Augustine Hachirutimana, a VMMC program coordinator, a nurse from Rwanda Japaigo office. I have to share with you nurses and midwives experience in scaling up early infant male circumcision service in Rwanda. Rwanda is a landlocked country located in Central Africa and is bordered by Uganda, Tanzania, Burundi, and DRC, Republic Democratic of Congo. Study have demonstrated that VMMC is up to 60% effective in reducing female to male HIV transmission. Since 2007, WHO and UNAIDS have recommended the VMMC, which is a voluntary medical circumcision, as an HIV prevention tool for HIV. And PEPFAR have supported the VMMC program implementation in 14 African countries where circumcision were low and HIV prevalence was high. Nearly 18.6 million of procedure was done, and some countries are preparing transition of their VMMC program from scale-up phase to the maintenance phase. The maintenance phase will focus on infant circumcision and the adolescent circumcision, 10 to 14 years. Then infant circumcision is defined as a circumcision which is done from 0 days up to 60 days. We are doing scale-up for those services. The government of Rwanda is a non-circumcising society, have adopted the voluntary medical male circumcision for HIV prevention in 2008. And the early infant circumcision was prioritized in the National Strategic Plan as an HIV prevention tool for long-term solution. In Rwanda, opportunity to integrate early infant male circumcision in maternal, newborn, and child health services exist, because 99% of pregnant mothers attend antenatal care, 99%, near 100% of born infants receive immunization, 50% of those infants are male, so that to integrate early infant male circumcision exists and it is possible here in Rwanda. The bottleneck number of providers trained the EMC, a number of facility delivering EMC services. To this end, it is crucial to build the capacity of public health sectors to integrate early infant male circumcision and offer the service. So the aim of this retrospective study is to assess the progress of integration of early infant male circumcision within maternal, neonatal, and child health services in Rwanda. We'll assess the progress. In 2015, the Minister of Health and UNICEF requested Japaigo to assess the technical component and support trainings. To respond to this request from the Minister of Health and UNICEF, Japaigo led the development of running resource package, focusing on the Mogeni clamp device. We have selected trainees based on their knowledge and the practice of the minor surgery and the surgical circumcision. We conducted trainings using a competency-based approach and a pre-test and post-test questionnaire was used to assess learners' knowledge. An immediate post-training follow-up or coaching was provided to ensure retention and the mastery of skills. We have introduced also a continuous quality improvement system to ensure that all domains are aligned in acceptable set of EMC standards. EMC, remember, it's early infant circumcision. We also developed a pool of national trainers to strengthen ownership and integration of the program. Yeah, some results, which is great. In the scale-up phase, early infant circumcision was introduced in 11 public health facilities as per the current table, where we trained at least one medical doctor and three nurses at the facility in the first pool. As you see from here, from 2016 to January 2019, 75 healthcare providers were trained, where 16 from the first batch were trained as a national trainer. Those national trainers, they co-trained subsequent sessions of new providers in their facilities. An average score have no significant difference from nurses and doctors, where in the pretest, both nurses and the medical doctors scored 67%. During the post-test, medical doctors scored 87, while nurses have scored 86%. There is no significant difference that can be found between those results of pre and post-test. In 11 health facilities implementing infant circumcision, 2,581 infants have been circumcised between the study period, and the nurses and the midwives have performed over 95% of the total procedure. This is a great achievement for nurses and the midwife. Only two glandular injuries were reported during training period, which were successfully managed on site. Conclusion: training providers on early infant circumcision using a competency-based approach is a first step to expand and integrate EMC services. Newborn male circumcision can be provided safely within maternal, neonatal, and child health services by healthcare providers trained in EMC. And EMC adverse events are minor and can be managed on site, but severe complications are rare and can require specialized care or referral. We highly recommend countries or governments to enhance the capacity of doctors to ease EMC program integration and ownership, strengthen nurses' collaboration with the Ministry of Health and the national stakeholders to ensure ever-increasing EMC coverage and program scale-up. Also, we recommend to establish a pool of national trainers for rapid scale-up early infant circumcision, even male circumcision, and institute a referral mechanism for adverse event management to array fear of provider and boost confidence for EMC providers. Thank you for ICN and Singapore to host this international conference. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, wonderful presentation. Do you have any question or comment? Just one, I can accept them to comment.
have mic?
Thank you very much. My name is Masako Kanaipa from Japan. I just want to make sure what I understand is correct or not. The male people have circumcised has less risk of having HIV. Is that correct? Well, what's the connection between the circumcision versus HIV infection?
Okay, thank you so much for the question. In 2007, there are three randomized controlled trial research done. One was done in Uganda. Next was conducted in South Africa, other in Kenya. Both study have demonstrated that VMMC, voluntary medical circumcision, can reduce HIV transmission up to 60%. Because the transmission of HIV, it pass through the, when you are doing sexual intercourse. And there is a, can say lesions through the skin, it comes up to the inner mucosa of the foreskin. Once a boy is circumcised, we remove the inner mucosa. It's where the prevention purpose comes from. Circumcising infants, it comes as a long-term strategy to sustain and prevent HIV.
Okay, thank you very much. Because in Japan, like just want to show you, circumcision is not the practice in Japan. That's why it's so very, you know, new idea and a new kind of thought. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I would like to move on next presentation. Next presentation is nurse staffing impact healthcare security. Here? No? Okay, welcome. No? Okay, this is a cancer edit. Next one, cynicism this year and legislation. Australia now sees a perspective on their experience of workplace aggression. Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Louisa. I'm the Deputy Dean and the head of nursing at the School of Nursing and Healthcare Professions at Federation University Australia. And our university is based in Melbourne, Victoria. Today, I'm presenting cynicism, despair, and resignation in Australian nurses' perspectives on their experience and workplace aggression. Workplace aggression in healthcare has been a major and seemingly intractable work health and safety concerns. And in the last 10 years, it has remained an unresolved issue. So we conducted, in 2017, we conducted a study on workplace aggression experience for nurses, midwives, and healthcare workers to collect information on prevalence, prevention, responses, and the impact data. And in our study, we defined workplace aggression into two different categories, verbal or written and physical threat. And for verbal and written, we can define that as abuse, threats, intimidation, or harassment, such as emails and abusive emails. And physical threats are defined as intimidation, harassment, and violence. In our study, we separated into two parts. The first part was a self-report, it's a survey, and we sent emails to Australian Nurses and Midwifery Federation in the Victoria membership, which has about 75,000 members. And in the second part, we conducted face-to-face interviews. And the survey period was only 2 months. And within that 2 months, we have received really, really good response. We had 1,224 respondents. And within those over 1,000 respondents, about 25% were agreed to participate in our face-to-face interview. And the result was very, very alarming. About 97% of our respondents told us that they had experienced workplace aggression in the last 12 months before they completed our survey. And most of them experienced verbal or written aggression, with about 80% of those aggression were from patients, 75% of them were from the relatives, and 70% from co-workers. Some of them experienced physical aggression. About over 70% of them were from patients, over 50% from relatives, and over 30% from their co-workers. And our result, when we asked them to how often do they report when they experience aggression, the results were very alarmingly low. Only about 9% of them say that most of the time they will report when they actually experience aggression. And up to 70% said they never report any of their aggression experience. The reason for non-reporting were due to many, many different reasons. It could be due to the omnibus of the reporting system, which I quote, one respondent said, "I've never seen a more complicated form in my life. You sit down with this bloody form and you are there forever and you just lose your will to live." And there, others were either too afraid or just accepted those aggression were part of life, part of their job. I quote, one respondent said, "You can complain, but it will come back to bite you. You will be ostracized in many ways and bullied out of your job or demoted." And another participant said, "I only report when I'm bleeding," because that's part of her job. That's what she thought. When they were asked what type of action they took with their aggression experience, about 35%, as high as up to 35%, actually had to seek psychological treatment, and 32% seek medical treatment. This indicates workplace aggression have very big impact on nurses' psychological, mental, and physical health. And as high as 48% of those respondents had to take time off work. That has very, very big impact on workforce and staffing planning, and consequently will affect our quality of our nursing care to our patients. For the question on satisfaction with institutional responses towards both external and internal aggression, only very, very few, very small percentage of respondents were very satisfied with their employing organization's response to their reporting. It's only 6 to 8%. And as high as up to 50% were very dissatisfied with their employing organization's support to their reporting. This tells us if anyone in the senior management in their hospital health services, there's a lot of work that they have to do to improve the management of all these incidents. Our study participants told us experience of workplace aggression left them distressed, angry, exhausted, and many of them feel belittled, undermined, unsupported, betrayed, and in despair. Some even admitted to having consequently experienced relationship breakdown, thoughts of suicide, and suicidal attempts. Here, I'm going to leave it to you, to the nurses, to highlight those implications by showing you some of their quotes. In summary, our study shows Australian nurses, midwives, and care personnel experience very high level, as high as 97% of aggression and violence. And very large proportion of those respondents did not report and simply accepted what happened to them. And the major factor of doing nothing was because of fear or problem with reporting system, insufficient time, difficulty on using incident report system, or very poor follow-up or action by their managers, and very poor satisfaction level. Now, due to very, very limited time in here, I cannot report a lot of information we've collected. So for our study, we actually published one paper. The first paper was published in Collegian last year, and the second paper is currently under review. And we also had one of our PhD students also publish another paper related to this workplace aggression in civilian experience in Collegian also last year. So if those, for those who are interested, please go to read those. In our next stage, my colleague and myself actually has collaborating with colleagues around the world, in Ireland, in the New York, in USA, and in China. We are doing another big study. It's called Global Respect, collecting information and developing strategies to manage workplace incivility and aggression. So if anyone who's interested or want to collaborate with us to make this study bigger around the world, please contact me through my email. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Wonderful presentation. Do you have any question or comment? No? Oh, okay.
Quick question. Did you look at if any of the nurse responders in your study had experience with training in de-escalation techniques, or is that something that you'll look at in the future?
We definitely could do a lot more, such as incorporating all this training, resilient training or management training within our Bachelor of Nursing training. So we are also looking into that as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We would like to move on next presentation. Next presentation is does the public injury violence adjust a health team under the certain collaboration? Okay, welcome.
Thank you. My name is Dr. Sigalit Volshavsky. I'm the head of the baccalaureate program in the nursing department in Tel Aviv University in Israel. And my presentation is very connected to the former one. I will describe our study, does the public justify violence against the health team under certain conditions? We all know that violence against healthcare teams is a widespread worldwide phenomenon with severe effects on health staff workers, the health organization, and society. I suppose that some of us even experienced violence as they were at their duty. Violence against healthcare teams is a complex, critical, sorry. Violence against healthcare teams is a widespread, a worldwide phenomenon. It's a critical issue, and therefore dealing with it is also complex and challenging. For the most part, the issue of violence in the health system has been studied from healthcare workers' point of view. Very few studies have been conducted to examine the public's perception. In Israel, it is the first study that examined this issue. The proposals of our studies were to examine the public's attitudes regarding workplace violence against healthcare teams and examine the intention to act violently towards healthcare teams in various health settings. A cross-sectional study using convenience sampling, the participants answered a closed questionnaire. Nurses enrolled in the nursing master program distributed the questionnaire. A total of 690 adult participants completed the questionnaire with a broad socioeconomic and educational background. The respondents were not at present or in the past part of a healthcare team. Our measurements. The questionnaire contained three sections. Part one was a socioeconomic demographic questionnaire. The questionnaire also included two questions that examined whether the participant had been exposed in the past to verbal or physical violence directed at healthcare teams in a health setting. Part two, attitude questionnaire. The questionnaire examined attitudes from several aspects. General attitude. Five questions engaged with the general attitude of participants regarding violence against healthcare teams. For example, violence is unpleasant behavior. The Alpha Kornbach for this scale was 0.84. Part B, justification for violence. Seven questions represented reasons that justify violence towards healthcare teams. For example, violence against healthcare teams is justified because the medical staff doesn't listen to the patient, or it is legitimate to hit healthcare workers if you feel that they are not doing their jobs. The Alpha Kornbach for this section was 0.78. Part C, preventive and punitive measures against violence. This part dealt with the public attitudes towards various measures that can prevent violence. For example, placing security personnel in each department or clinic and deterrence through punishing violent individuals. For example, 6 months in prison for physically injuring a staff member. And the last part, supporting violent behavior questionnaire. This part included three short sentences that described violent verbal reactions by a patient or his family directed at healthcare workers in a hospital setting. For example, a patient shouts and curses at the nurse after waiting an hour for pain relief. The answer expressed the agreement with the violent reaction of the patient or his family. In all parts, the participants were asked to rate their agreement with each statement on a Likert scale of 1 to 4 or 1 to 6. A high score for each subscale reflects a strong agreement regarding the measures suggested. All the attitude subscales had high internal confidence. Part three was a behavioral intention to violence. This part contained three scenarios. These scenarios were presented with four optional answers on a Goodman scale. Participants were asked to choose one of four options of action that describe a sequence of non-respond to physical violent reactions. As you can see, we have here the three scenarios. Scenario one is waiting for a vaccine. You have scheduled an appointment for a vaccination at the community clinic. You arrived at the clinic in time, but it turned out that you would have to wait another 40 minutes before you could meet the nurse. How do you think you would behave in this situation? Scenario two,
only wanted to ask the nurse a question. You have come to the community clinic to ask the nurse a short question that bothers you. Many patients are waiting in the waiting room. Nevertheless, you opened the door of the nurse's room and asked if you could ask a short question. The nurse asks you to take a number and wait for your turn. How do you think you would behave in this situation? And scenario three, waiting for a bed in the ward. You accompany your father during hospitalization in an internal ward. The department is crowded and there is no bed for him in the room. Your father received the bed in the hallway. Suddenly, you find out that a patient who came after you to the ward receives a bed in a room. How do you think you would behave in this situation? Findings. Okay, we have table one that actually describes the sample characteristics. A total of 690 participants completed the questionnaire. About 48% were men and 51% were women. The women were significantly more educated than the men, but their income was lower. Significantly more men than women had witnessed verbal or physical violence in the health system. Attitudes toward violence against healthcare team. Overall, the participants considered violent behavior towards the health teams to be a harmful phenomenon. Participants supported the adoption of preventive measures in order to decrease violent behavior directed at healthcare teams, but thought only some punitive measures could prevent violence. There was little agreement among the participants regarding justification of violence, yet significantly more men than women justified violent behavior. Similarly, significantly more men than women were supportive of violent behavior throughout the health team. In contrast, more women than men agreed with preventive measures. This table actually describes logistic regression that we have done. It was conducted to predict the intention to behave violently in each scenarios, the scenarios that I described earlier. The predictors were gender, level of education, income, witnessing verbal or physical violence, justification for violence towards the health team, preventive measures, and supporting violent behavior. Justification for violence towards health teams and supporting violent behavior were the only attitudes that predicted violent intention in all three scenarios. For example, in scenario two, among participants who justified violence, violent behavior was considered the best way to shorten the line to the nurse by nearly four times more than other participants. In scenario three, participants who supported violent behavior towards the health team also thought almost two times more than the other participants that behaving in a violent manner was the way to ensure that they would get a bed in the ward ahead of other participants. Education level in scenario two and having previously witnessing physical violence in scenario three were other variables that could explain the behavioral intention to violence. Interestingly, participants who expressed more confidence in preventive measures expressed less support for violence in scenario two and three. Main thing. The public perceives violence toward healthcare teams as a negative phenomenon and supports preventive and punitive measures intended to prevent such violence. Men and women differ in their attitudes and tendency to act violently while presented to real incidents from everyday life in the health system. People who justified and supported violent behavior are also more likely to act violently according to the scenarios presented to them. The current study is the first to examine the public perception and tendency to violent behavior directed towards healthcare teams in Israel and globally. Such violence in a healthcare setting is a worldwide phenomenon and its eradication deserves to be made a high priority. The findings can be used by healthcare policymakers to promote staff education and training, including improving staff-patient communication, learning to perform violence risk assessment, acquiring skills in de-escalation, dealing with stress, and preventing violence. It is important to know that while the public understands that violence in a healthcare setting is undesirable and harmful, the phenomenon still exists.
It is therefore necessary to continue to promote propaganda concerning this subject and to stress the severe consequences of directing violent behavior towards healthcare teams. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Do you have any question?
Thank you very much. This is a very important topic. My question is, what do you expect from the policymakers or regulators to do about the public education or public, maybe disciplinary actions that can be done to prevent such violence?
I really think that going on with propaganda, with advertisement, and to educate the public will actually help. We can use the internet, the media, any tool that we have to have people to understand that it is harmful and shouldn't be there. Like the former presenter that described the staff viewpoint, I think this is complementary and we should work together to decrease it. We have actually a couple of articles that are reviewed right now. One was already published, and there are several that are in a review, and they will be published nearby. Thank you.
Thank you again. I would like to move on next speaker. Next speaker is an expert study of stories on facing parent violence and coping strategy in nurses. Welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'm Yifei Zhong. I come from Taiwan. I'm head nurse of psychiatric ward. It's honors for me to be here. I'm very happy to have this opportunity to share my study. My topic is an exploratory studies of stress on facing patients' violence and coping stages in nurses. First of all, we're talking about background. In recent years, considerable concern has risen over medical violence in clinical nurses. Draft global plan of actions on violence highlighting the leading role that nurses play in addressing violence. ICN confirmed is committed to working with government to eliminate discrimination and violence in health workplace. Patient-centered and gender sensitivity service, promotions of human rights. For prevalence, the physical violence is mostly in emergency room and psychiatric department. The verbal violence and bullying behaviors is taught in every place university. In Taiwan, the workplace violence in nurses. Over 44 workplace violence on emergency room of regional hospitals. This is the 1 year prevalence rate. In Taiwan, 2018, the mostly bullying behavior is about 74%. The system review, the mostly sexual harassment is about 34%. This study was focused on facing patients' violence behavior, including physical and verbal violence. The purpose of this study is to compare the psychiatric and non-psychiatric nurses. First, the situational stress. Second, the stress coping responses. Third, the anxiety level. This study designs was causation proposed simply design study. For the participant, we recruit a regional hospital in middle of Taiwan. The nurses work in psychiatric department. emergency room, and intensive care unit. For the ESCO consideration, the IRB approved and informed consent. For the instrument, the self-admitted questionnaire, first, demographic questionnaire, second, coping behavior scale. There are 18 items. Third, Chinese versions of back anxiety inventory is scoring. For recording process, participate from psychiatric ward, emergency room, and intensive care unit. Inclusion criteria. First, want to participate in had experience of this unit, ability to communicate and read Chinese, and complete all the questionnaire. So, and totally complete were 198 people. For declarations and analysis, from June 2016 to December 2017, data analysis were conducted using SPSS. This is instrument, variable, and status. For a demographic, according to this table, we could see the unit for ICU have 52%, the ER 16%, and the psychiatric nurses 31%. The gender is mostly female. Average age is around 31 years old. The education is mostly bachelor degree. The marriage state is mostly single. Average job tenure is around 7 years. The ICU is about 6 years. ER about 7 years. Psychiatric ward 9 years. Nurses contain patients time 6 to 8 hours a day. Is about 46%. Participating virus will happen anytime is mostly about 66%. When the workplace virus happen, nurses will notifications to their supervisor will 92%. When the workplace virus happen, nurses will continue their work is about 67%. And the nurses have had virus experience when patients' conditions related to alcoholism-induced disorganized, irritable mood, and delayed problems. And we're talking about virus situations that nurses suffering. From this table, the mostly suffering experience for psychiatric nurse is sudden suicide or self-harm behaviors. And for ICU nurses, it's sudden physical violence. But in the ER, they suffer from all the scenarios. This table shows psychiatric nurse, ICU, and ER nurse in BAI and CBS scores. And I use ANOVA. There are no significant correlation. And I try to run for psychiatric compare again, a group of ICU and the ER. And I use T-test. The BAI shows significant between psychiatric nurse and others, but CBS still no significant. For discussion, the anxiety level of psychiatric nurse is significantly lower than others, maybe related to often training of dealing with violence, learning self-defense skill, participating in the violence prevention education. Nurses is the occupations of high emotion level and working stress. So we need more multiple interventions and need to staff retention. For this study, we maybe could know job tenure more long stress position and low emotion coping behavior. For conclusion and recommendation, the nurses should be clearly identify the signs of workplace violence, develop effective response strategies, will help nurses to stay away from workplace violence. The high-risk units of potential violence will be attention. The high-risk units should be violence rehearsal or related education and training. The resource will not be in psychiatric unit, especially like security or isolated space. And we also have limitations. It's difficult to distinguish the trait anxiety and state anxiety to affect the facing violence. The factor affecting anxiety level of psychiatry and others is for future approach and future research declaration. It's my reference. Thank you for your attention. And welcome to Taiwan in 2020. Thank you.
Thank you, wonderful presentation. Do you have any question or comment? No? No question? Yes. Okay. Everybody okay? Okay, yes. Thank you so much again. Yeah. I would like to move on to last speakers. Last speaker is active excellent in nursing and midwife. New graduate designated as Rose Collaborations. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Robin Fox, and I currently have the pleasure of holding the position of Professor of Nursing and Midwifery Professional Education for Metro North Hospital and Health Service and Queensland University of Technology. My presentation this afternoon, or this evening, I should say, and I do appreciate that I'm standing between you and leaving and going home this evening. My presentation is related to excellence in collaboration and what we do to go about increasing and getting a better product with regards to employing our new graduate nurses. Okay. Right, so Metro North, now this presentation is on behalf of Metro North Hospital and Health Service. However, the activities and the outcomes will also benefit our university colleagues. So Metro North, the contribution of Metro North, composition I should say, is the green area that you see on the screen. We have in excess of 8,000 nursing and midwifery staff. Now that was the census taken at the end of last year. I'm under the impression now that we're heading closer towards about 8.5 towards 9,000. And in the next 18 months, we'll be going towards 10,000 nursing staff. We have two tertiary quaternary hospitals, two major community hospitals, one rural community hospital, three directorates, which include mental health, oral health, and community health, and medical imaging. And we have one major correctional centre, which comes under the jurisdiction of one of our community hospitals. So from green at the bottom to green at the top, it's 90 kilometres in distance. And so we spend a lot of time going backwards and forwards and around across the health service. And I'd like to acknowledge the Executive Director for Nursing for Metro North is sitting in the audience, and the Vice Chancellor for QUT now, Patsy Yates, who's also sitting in the audience. Okay, so what did we do? What was the intent of doing this project? We wanted to reduce duplication and variance in the new graduate recruitment processes across Metro North. What we had is we had five hospitals and three directorates, and we were all competing against each other. And how we were competing against each other was quite disparate, and we were all looking at different ways and different processes and looking at how, with our graduate numbers, there was no rhyme or reason. Every hospital was just looking at what did they do and how did they go about doing it. We needed to look at coming together as a workforce from a leadership perspective and from an education support perspective so that we could look at meeting workforce demand. We also wanted to look at how we're going to address the predetermined new graduate targets. Now, these graduate targets are given to us from a political commitment of having to employ a certain number of new graduates each year, and then we get funding related to those graduate targets. We also wanted to attract a very high quality graduate pool, and we thought that by working together rather than working against each other and vying for each of the graduates, we'd be able to do this by looking, sharing our resources and moving forward as one. So what did we do? Well, we thought we had a long period of time. So we formed a subgroup. I chair a nursing and midwifery education group for the health service, and we formed a subgroup for that under that governance. I also have the pleasure of sitting on the Strategic Executive Council for the health service, and this was sponsored by the Executive Director of Nursing for the Health Service. We then did internal and external benchmarking so that we could redefine and come up with one standard generic HHS or hospital and health service process. And that was quite interesting because there wasn't a lot to actually benchmark against. And we found that most of our colleagues, there are 16 health services in Queensland, in Australia, and the rest of the other health services in other states, they were all basically vying against each other. The other people that we were vying against is we were a public hospital sector and we were vying against the private sector at the same time. So we sat down as a group and we used an action learning research perspective. We worked through together as a learning circle, and we started to come up with what were going to be our agreed strategies. And I can tell you at the very beginning, when we sat down at a group and we had 14 people in the room representing each of our facilities, we didn't have an agreed strategy. After a few weeks, we started to get that agreed strategy. So we agreed that we would actually share our recruitment resources, which would be the first time ever since we'd come together as a health service. We looked at, we'd had change our presence with our internet, come up with something that was a more vibrant to attract our graduates. We looked at changing our recruitment timelines prior to starting to look at this initiative. Each of the facilities would return, interview the graduates and start to employ the graduates at different times. We also then looked at what was our marketing strategy, and we found out that, again, it was very mixed and it wasn't very effective whatsoever. So we wanted to change that strategy, and we wanted the whole health service to be able to work really collectively together to have that engagement and that vibrancy so that we went forward as one accord, and that we could then encourage our potential applicants and then come forward as being the health service of choice across the state. We also had our workforce planning colleagues model and inform us about what were our graduate workforce needs. And while I'm talking about this new graduate, I neglected to say, I'm terribly sorry, that I'm talking about registered nurses at this stage. We have registered nurses and enrolled nurses, but we're talking, this particular presentation is about registered nurses. So we modelled what our workforce needed to look like. We modelled how many new graduates we needed to take each year, and we modelled how many each facility needed to take. We then also wanted to look at, were our graduates going to be satisfied with the strategies we put into place? So we developed and thought we'd wait for that particular strategy. So we then obtained ethics approval and came up with a Delphi study to look at that satisfaction. That study is just being written up at this particular point, and we'll be looking at publishing the outcome of that study. Okay, so our commitment. We had extensive, robust debate about how we were going to establish the scope, what were our relationships we were going to establish, and the thing that we needed to do the most was establish the trust that, one, the large facilities wouldn't take all the best or the cream of the crop of the new graduates and leave the smaller rural or the community facilities without any graduates. That was a little bit of an exercise on public relations in getting that trust to occur, but it worked quite well. And my colleague Megan Lowe, who chaired one of these committees, was instrumental in assisting with some of those community groups. We had agreement to foster the reputation and regard for the health service. We wanted to be number one. Our executive director of nursing and our chief executive of the health service likes us to be, we're one of the largest in the country, and they like to say that not only we are the biggest and the best, but we are also the most friendly. And that was the message we wanted to convey to our new graduates. So we started to work along, and we were going quite well, and we'd had about four or five meetings, and then suddenly the government changed the process of how we were going to employ new graduates. We used to have two intakes a year, and the graduates apply through what is called a graduate portal. And that's a statewide portal where every graduate who finishes each year has to apply through that to be able to be eligible for public sector hospital employment. So the graduates don't come to the hospitals, they actually go through this portal. The portal is open for a certain period of time, and then at the closure, so after about 2 months, that portal closes, and then we can then start to look at how do we accept those grads or how do we take those new graduates. But what happened was is that they changed the rules of the game, and we were starting to get these nice strategies in place and starting to work together very effectively, and we were told that we had 3 weeks to come up with some strategies because we were no longer having a mid-year intake available to the portal and only having an end-of-year intake for the portal. So we worked very hard. A number of people went offline to work on this. Our graduate recruitment officers did a wonderful job, and we came up with our first iteration of what was going to be the shared process in 3 weeks, which was absolutely incredible. And everybody played to the game, nobody broke ranks. So what we decided, we would interview all our first and second preference new graduates that came to us, and that sits at around 1,500. However, we get in the vicinity of over 3,000 applications. As you might have heard the chief nurse for Queensland speaking earlier, we have a glut of new graduates at this particular point. Okay, so what we then looked at is that we moved from working separately to an approach whereby we were working very, very effectively together. And we looked at the aspect of employing at least 5% of our workforce as new graduates each year. So that rests around the 350 to 420, just depending on the year. And that was well and above what we were requiring to do for the targets. And indeed, we received an honourable mention from across the state, by the Office of Chief Nurse as doing the heavy work in meeting the targets for new graduates for the 2 years of that requirement. We improved all our processes, we changed all of our resources, and we changed the way that we engaged. And that was the commitment, and that commitment is still held. So what did we achieve? We achieved a whole raft of business rules, which we used to set the processes. So anyone coming in to work into those roles as a graduate coordinator or as a nurse educator knows exactly what's expected, how we work through and take our annual intake. We have a highly successful application triage process. So the portal opens in August, it then closes towards the end of September, and we start to interview come October. There is 1 week in September where our graduate coordinators sit down and they triage all of the 3,000 plus applications. They then work through and look at what are the first and second preferences, and then we all come together as a group that's responsible for this, and we sit down and we trade the preferences. So we look at who might want to go to community, who might want to go to the tertiary quaternary facilities, who might want to go to oral health, and we make sure that there is an adequate graduate pool for each of those areas so that no one misses out. Mental health used to miss out, and consequently we've actually made now that they are getting a very large graduate intake. We've developed a question bank. We interview the same week we use the same questions across. If we think that the questions have been compromised, we change those questions and we work across the health service to do that. We look at maintaining equity, natural justice, and we contextualise the questions to suit the practice area. We are actually the employer of choice for new graduates and have been so for the last 3 years and hope to be so for this year as well. We have a shared waitlist, so we don't just employ all of those grads. We don't take 1,500 new graduates into the facilities in one go. We employ those grads over the 12-month period. They're employed, if they're successful at interview, they'll get a waitlist, they'll be told about their waitlist, and then we give them a date for employment. And they wait on the waitlist, and we move them around. We employ the new graduates in a part-time capacity and under a contract position in the first instance. Within the first 18 months of their employment, though, we translate them as soon as we can to a permanent position. 98% of the grads, so I can't share the full results of the Delphi study, But of that, 98% of the grads were highly satisfied with the progress and with the support that had been provided to them within the first 5 months of transitioning to their practice. And we have a very, very robust transition to practice program. And some of you may have seen our posters whereby we have career pathways, developmental maps, and the chief nurse also put some of those up as well. And that's been very positive in achieving our graduate support. We're increasing our integration and our teamwork. We're having better communication and collaboration across the health service. Other health services are coming to us to ask what we've been doing so that we can make and to assist them in attracting the same volume of new graduates. And our attrition rate is very low, 3 to 5%, which sits around no more than 20 grads of the number that we employ. So overall, we believe that we are working towards excellence. As you heard our executive director speaking yesterday, we didn't go down the magnet pathway. However, we're going down the excellence pathway, and this has just been one of the strategies that is assisting us in looking forward and moving the leadership of Metro North forward. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much. We can just one question.
There are grads, by the way. There are some of our grads, by the way.
Okay.
Oh. Sorry.
Yes.
Congratulations. What kind of questions do you ask in that interview?
Oh, what kind of questions? We ask them safety questions, clinical safety questions. So they write a small 500-word little essay while they're waiting for their interview, and they know about this because we go out to our university partners. We market really strongly with our university partners. We're invited all the time, so they know exactly what's expected of them. So they have a small little essay question, and then we ask them clinical safety questions. So we give them case scenarios, and we ask them things like a medication safety, a fall safety, but related to nurse-sensitive indicators. And it's really quite interesting, and we all use that same bank of questions which we rotate through. So they're very general questions, and the questions can, the mental health use a different bank of questions, and maternity use a different bank of questions, but in every other area, intensive care, emergency, med-surg, it's all related to them being able to be a generalist nurse and to be safe in practice. Does that answer your question? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful presentation again. So today's presentation schedules are finished. In closing, I would like to thank the speaker for their contribution, and also thank you audience for many suggestions and comments. Thank you again. Thank you so much.